we've been going on.
It was a bit dodgy. If you were in favour, fine. But people did get nervous, you know? Because Ben could turn against you on the strength of a mediocre performance. Artists were always in a great dither. Have you been invited to the party on the last night? And if you hadn't, it means that you'd somehow failed and you might never be asked again.
Aldborough, which had been so inspiring and evocative for Britain, now turned into a mean-spirited prison. Over the years, the casualty list of those not invited back grew and grew. The official explanation for the departure of so many glossed over Britain's increasingly petty-minded vindictiveness. Those who lasted the pace at Aldborough were total devotees and acolytes, like Imogen Holst, who sacrificed a composing career of her own to sit at the master's feet. But did this increasingly sycophantic atmosphere matter?
We know he didn't like criticism, but at the same time, I think as the sort of artist he was, the fact that almost everything he said was law and that all these people jumped to his command must at the same time have fed this insecurity and this feeling that he might dry up at any time.
They gave him what he wanted, which was a feeling of being loved in spite of anything. He could do anything, they'd still love him. Whereas in fact, I think had there been a little more criticism about, he might have become a little bit braver in those terms.
Tiger, tiger, burning bright.
The decline in Britain's songwriting is widely admitted. In my view, his songs were always a mixed bag. Britain preferred to set great poetry, not because he could meet the challenge, but because he needed the support. His snobbery about texts meant he could use a Purcellian technique to string together picturesque phrases. But now, the music didn't just miss the spirit of the poetry, it detracted from it.
That's a work in which you can hear the musical schemes churning round and round. You can hear where every note comes from. One really does feel that he fails because he's cast out so much of the brightness of the music and so much of the liveliness. He fails in that case to catch the sort of visionary side.
A curious bleakness settled over Aldborough. Britain's need for bourgeois respectability and paranoia about criticism undermined his composing. The most serious decline was in opera. The barren harvest of church parables was followed by Owen Wingrave and Death in Venice, two works that leave many people cold.
So often, for example, in Mozart, one feels that at some moment, which may be in quite a trivial situation, perhaps part of a comedy, the music lifts the experience to something beyond that immediate dramatic situation. And this is something which I experience rarely with Britain. One doesn't feel that transcendental quality.
It's significant that this is the quality that can be found in the operas of Michael Tippett. Britain's near contemporary was not just a pacifist and homosexual like Britain. He was also never bothered about respectability or what others thought. Tippett's work may lack the neatness and technical sophistication of Britain, but it's imbued with a glowing, passionately affirmative humanity. It mixes Indian mysticism with Jungian psychology, an attack on capitalism with support for women's lib. Risky, but it succeeds.
There has always been a gritty intensity about Michael Tippett's music, which I think gives it a strength and this transcendental quality which is the mark of a great composer.
By contrast, where's the universality of Death in Venice, Britain's last major work? Britain's final opera is adapted from Thomas Mann's story about an aging literary lion sexually obsessed by a beautiful boy. It's really the last of the church operas, this time written from the confessional box. Auden noted Britain's attraction to what he termed thin-as-a-board juveniles. Death in Venice seems like a private testament, a self-advertisement, a bid for pity more than a campaign for liberation. There's not much for the audience to identify or empathize with.
As far as I can see, Death in Venice is a bit of a cop-out. I mean, from Thomas Mann as well, what they're basically saying is there's a sexual feeling which they cannot immediately admit, and they will call it beauty or call it something Greek in order that the real feeling won't be too difficult for them to accept.
And with a work like Death in Venice, which was his swan song in a sense, it is about his life with Peter Piers and it's about what he was. I don't think that it really mattered at that point, because everybody knew and everybody accepts homosexuality in society, at least in the arts world, and I don't think that it's particularly moving in that sense.
Ben's music, I'm turned to ice with admiration for it, but it doesn't hit me in the belly button.
Britten hid himself away in a world of personal fears, secure from the threat of critics and new ideas. An industry has grown up around his music. People with an investment in his mythical status would not take part in this program. They would prefer to enthrone him as a great European composer. In truth, his talents were miserably distorted by insecurity. Vaughan Williams and Elgar, whom he so despised, will continue to outshine him.